I don't normally like cake. Almost all cakes look better than they taste, but not this one. Earl Grey chiffon cake might not look like much. I mean, it's overly big and kind of clumsy looking. It has no layers and it's kind of gray. But one bite and you'll understand what the fuss is about. The texture of this cake is so light and airy. It's hard to believe this cake can support its weight without collapsing. This light as a cloud cake is punctuated by tea leaves and coated in the tea-infused whipped cream. This has been the official birthday cake of my family for about 15 years. I stumbled on it at a tiny Japanese bakery in Boston. It was called Cafe Cakes. The genius behind Cafe Cakes was Noriko Tamada. Although all her cakes were delicious, the Earl Grey chiffon cake was out of this world. It was the first time in my life that I actually wanted a cake for my birthday. Unfortunately, my cake euphoria didn't last long. You see, a few years after I discovered Cafe Cakes, Noriko moved back to Japan. It was a sad, sad day for cake lovers in Boston. How could she just leave us like that? I mean, doesn't she have her priority straight? There was no way around it. I had to learn to make that cake. Given my learning disability when it comes to anything sugar and flour related, I expected it to take years, but it only took one try. In fact, it's the only time in my life that a baked good worked out for me on the first try. I got a recipe for chiffon cake from The Joy of Cooking, replaced the liquid component with very strong tea, and it worked. So if baking gives you heebie-jeebies, this is a perfect place to start. At least 2 hours before making the batter, steep 3 tablespoons of good quality Earl Grey tea in 2 cups of boiling water. I don't recommend using tea bags for this cake since most tea bags contain ground up leaves and we want whole leaves here. We need them for texture. I realized that this tea is way too strong to drink. We needed this way to balance the sugar in the cake. A huge chiffon cake can only take about 1 cup of tea, so this tea needs to be insanely strong for its flavor to come through. Why are we brewing 2 cups of tea? To have backup. If something goes wrong with your recipe and you need to restart, you don't want to wait another 2 hours for tea to brew and cool, right? So if you're in a rush and if you don't want to wait for tea to cool, give it 15 minutes to brew and then set it in a nice water bath until it gets to room temperature, somewhere between 68 and 78 Fahrenheit. While my tea is cooling, I get my eggs out of the fridge for a couple of hours to bring them to room temperature too. Cold whites will not reach their full volume, so be very careful that all ingredients for the batter are between 68 and 78 Fahrenheit. If you want to speed up the warming up of the eggs, put them in warm water for 5 minutes before you crack and separate them. Okay, our tea is ready. Let's preheat the oven to 325 Fahrenheit and make the batter. Place 256 grams of cake flour, 285 grams of granulated sugar, 1 tablespoon of baking powder, and 1 teaspoon table salt or 2 teaspoons diamond crystal kosher salt into a sifter. Sift all these dry ingredients into a medium bowl. If some sugar or salt crystals are large enough that they don't want to go through a sieve, just discard them. Now, we'll set a sieve over a large bowl and sift the dry ingredients again. Sifting twice distributes the baking powder more evenly and ensures that your cake will have good texture. We'll need 5 large yolks, about 90 grams, and 8 large whites, about 240 grams for this recipe. The yolks should go into a medium bowl and the whites should go into a large mixer bowl if you're using a stand mixer like KitchenAid. That's the standard mixer bowl. It is extremely important for the mixer bowl to be perfectly clean. If any yolk or some other fat gets into the whites, they won't reach their full volume. That's why I like to have a temporary little bowl for my whites. If a yolk breaks, I'll just discard that egg without contaminating all my whites. I know it's not very elegant, but my favorite way to separate eggs is to crack an egg into a bowl and scoop out the yolk with my fingers. I find that it's faster than pouring the egg back and forth between the shells, and unlike the sharp shells, my fingers almost never break the yolk. Put the bowl with the yolks on the scale and add 177 grams of tea, 112 grams of canola oil or any neutral oil like grapeseed, vegetable or safflower, and 1 teaspoon of vanilla extract or paste. Whisk these wet ingredients until perfectly smooth. I like to use a hand mixer for this, but you can also do it with a whisk. Squeeze out and add 3 firmly packed tablespoons of tea leaves. They make the texture of the cake much more interesting. Then add all this wet stuff to the flour mixture and fold it in using a spatula. Make sure you don't have any more streaks of flour, and if you encounter any lumps, squash them against the side of the bowl. As I was mixing this batter, I realized that adding dry ingredients on top of wet might result in fewer lumps, but I find that with chiffon cakes, overmixing isn't nearly as big of a problem as it is with other cakes. You don't want to mix this batter just for fun, but it's okay to gently squash all the lumps. Now let's prepare the egg whites. Add 1/2 teaspoon of cream of tartar to the egg whites and whip them using the whisk attachment. Start on low speed and gradually crank it up to high. When the whites get to foamy but still droopy stage, gradually beat in 57 grams of granulated sugar and continue beating on high speed until the whites get to stiff peaks. Yes, it's possible to overbeat egg whites, so check the mixture frequently. Oh no, I totally overexposed my whites. That's not a cooking term, it's a photography term. White stuff is so hard to film, but that's okay. You'll see the texture when we fold them into the batter. Start with a third of the whites. When the whites are almost integrated into the batter, add the remaining whites and fold them until the mixture is completely homogeneous. Make sure you use the folding motion, not stirring motion. Cut through the whites to the bottom of the bowl and lift the batter up. With the other hand, rotate the bowl after each fold. Be patient. It's a lot of batter to mix, but it's important to be thorough or you'll get white streaks in your cake and the texture won't be right. Now let's talk about the bakeware. If you want the best possible texture for your cake, a tube pan is a must. Mine is 9.5 inches in diameter. Do not grease the pan. The cake needs to stick to the sides to prevent collapse after baking. If you're using a 10-inch pan, add all the batter. If you're using a 9.5-inch pan, I suggest you remove 100 grams of batter from the bowl before filling your pan. Normally, I put all the batter in the pan and after it's baked, the cake domes slightly and needs to be leveled. When making this video, I saved 100 grams of batter to use for cupcakes and the cake came out perfectly level with no need for trimming. So in the future, I think I'll just discard 100 grams of batter so that my cake doesn't need trimming. After you add the batter, smooth it out with a spatula. An offset spatula works particularly well for this. I meant to tap the cake on the counter to get rid of large bubbles, but I completely forgot. So shh, I won't tell if you won't tell. Another way to get rid of bubbles before you bake is to put the batter in the pan and then run a skewer through it all over before baking. Another option for this batter is to make cupcakes. These 5-ounce baking cups need 50 grams of batter each, so the whole batch produces roughly 24 cupcakes. After you fill the cups, tap them on the counter a few times to distribute the batter evenly and get rid of large air bubbles. Put the cakes or cupcakes in the middle of 325 Fahrenheit oven and bake until the skewer comes out clean. Start testing the cupcakes after 30 minutes and the cake after 60 minutes. For a large cake, I try a few spots. It is safer to overbake a little than underbake. If you watch my other videos, you'll notice that I'm a huge believer in thermometers. But I've noticed that thermometers sometimes mislead me when it comes to cakes and breads. I'm not sure if the reason for it is the texture of baked goods. When you stick a thermometer into a cake, you are basically sticking it into hot air. And these thermometers are really meant for denser stuff like meat or water. Another reason for it might be that breads and cakes need not only to reach a particular temperature, but sit at that temperature for a few minutes to set. So I use a thermometer as one data point, but not the only one. If my thermometer is reading below 200 Fahrenheit, there is no way the cake is ready. But if it is reading 200 Fahrenheit or higher, I use a toothpick as a confirmation that the crumb structure is really set. Cupcakes are so little they don't collapse, so you can just cool them on a rack. But the cake can totally collapse. To avoid that, it needs to be cooled upside down. Insert a wine bottle into the center of the cake and flip it over. So in case you're wondering, why chiffon cakes aren't usually baked in normal round cake pans? That's why. A tube pan gives you more walls for support, resulting in a cake that's particularly tall and fluffy. It allows you to get the cake so stuck in the pan that you can cool it upside down without the cake falling out. But it also offers a mechanism for unsticking the cake once it's cool. If you get a cake this stuck in a round cake pan, good luck getting it out. Cool the cake completely. That will take about 2 hours, and then you can get it out. To remove the cake from the pan, use an offset spatula to cut all around the cake. I prefer a spatula because I don't like using my sharp knives on metal pans. Go around the inner tube too and lift the cake out. Then insert the spatula between the bottom of the pan and the cake. Flip the cake onto a serving dish or a cake turntable if you have one. Oops, I got a hole. Should have tapped that cake. But once we ice it, no one will know. For cupcakes, go over the outside with a spatula and then dig it under a little bit, and the cupcake will come out. Okay, time for the whipped cream. Pour 90 grams of tea, no leaves this time, into a microwavable cup. Sprinkle 1 teaspoon of gelatin evenly over the surface of the tea. Let the gelatin soften without stirring for 5 minutes. Put in the microwave just until all the gelatin is melted. Check every 10 seconds. After the first 10 seconds, I still saw gelatin specks. After 10 more seconds, I saw fewer specks. And after 10 more seconds, everything melted. If you don't have a microwave, you can also set this cup into a pan of simmering water for about a minute to achieve the same result. Cool the tea to about 70 Fahrenheit. While the tea is cooling, chill a mixer bowl and a whisk attachment in the fridge for at least 15 minutes. To make whipped cream, everything needs to be cold, the cream, the beater, and the bowl. Sift 56 grams of powdered sugar. You might need to help yourself with fingers a bit to make it all go through the sieve. When the tea and gelatin mixture is close to 70 Fahrenheit, stir in 1 teaspoon of vanilla extract or paste. Put 464 grams of cold heavy cream into a cold bowl and start whipping it on medium speed. When the mixture gets slightly foamy, crank up the speed to high. When the cream starts to thicken, very slowly pour in the tea mixture. Reduce speed to medium low and add the powdered sugar a spoonful at a time. Stop the mixer to scrape down the sides of the bowl. And beat on high speed until the cream is thick and holds stiff peaks. Careful not to overwhip or you'll get butter. When you're done, the cream should look like this. I learned from my egg white mistake how to film white stuff, so you can actually see what I'm doing for a change. So the cupcakes are easy. You just pipe on the cream and you're done. But the cake, oh my gosh. I am so not the person to teach you how to frost a cake. Basically, I just smear the cream on with an offset spatula. I used to just do it on a plate with a butter knife. The turntable and the offset spatulas are very recent purchases. And then I heard that you should do this thing called crumb coating. That means coating the cake with a thin layer of cream to seal in the crumbs and then putting it in the freezer for about 15 minutes to set before frosting it the second time. This way you won't have any crumbs showing in your frosting. So I'll be honest with you, it's the first time I'm crumb coating anything, really. So, okay, into the freezer we go. And then 15 minutes later, let's finish this thing. More cream, more smearing, even more cream and even more smearing. As always, I gave up on producing nice smooth sides and just drew some lines to cover up all the imperfections. Then I piped the remaining cream into some weird asymmetrical ruffle thing until I ran out of cream. After you're done torturing your cake, it is very important that you put it in the fridge for at least 4 hours. It is absolutely not okay to serve this cake right away. The cream texture will be all wrong. For cupcakes, it's important to keep them in an airtight container or they'll dry up. The cake doesn't need any coverage, the cream will protect it. I find that this cake tastes best the day after it's made, but it will keep well in the fridge for up to 4 days. There is nothing particularly pretty or gooey about this cake, but the flavor is unbelievable. I think you can see the texture better on a big cake. As usual, I'll provide links to equipment like the tube pan and baking cups below this video. Since there's so many different components and steps to this cake, I will also give you a link to a written recipe. Yeah, not just ingredients like I usually do, but the entire procedure as well. Here are more thought-provoking culinary videos for you to check out. And if you are ever in the Boston area, maybe I'll see you in one of my classes.